Thank you, Minister Garrett. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
I'm wearing my big old floppy sun hat here today. Sister Rosalind gave me this for Christmas. So the next time I'm out in the sun, I got it covered. I'm not supposed to have prolonged contact with the sun. I asked the doctor why. One of the medications says avoid prolonged contact in the sun. He said, I really don't know why, but you really don't want to find out why if you challenge it. So I'm probably just going to stay away. And that and grapefruit. I don't like grapefruit anyway, so that's not an issue. But you can't help sometimes being out in the sun. Anyway, I can't see too well, but it's okay. Anyhow, this thing is working way far away from me. Good morning. I was wondering if you were here yet. I came out and saw your door open. Let's see. Today we're going to have kind of limited time after service. So when the groceries arrive, we will have the grocery distribution. But the coffee service, we're reducing it down to just one pot today. We need to finish early so that I can get home. Pastor Tony's not here today. He's resting. He is getting stronger. He's eating well. He's getting better. He's walking more. And I wanted to just leave him behind today so he can get the rest he needs. So keep him in prayer. He's getting better. I promise he is. He's gonna be back with us shortly. And let's see. I don't know if we have any clothing today. There is clothing today. Okay. But as soon as we wrap all that up, then we're going to close our doors and get back to our families. It's getting closer to Christmas, so there's a lot of things everybody needs to get done. And Sister Geraldine has a long drive. She has to go back to Palmdale, get all the food together and everything else for her ministry tonight, come all the way back. So we want to make sure she can get out of here in a reasonable amount of time. And so it's going to be a little different today. We won't have three pots of coffee. We're only going to have one. But it's going to be the biggest one. So as soon as we're done serving that, we're going to close the doors. And we have a private gathering scheduled for inside the church today. So let's see. Next Sunday is Christmas Eve. So we're going to have a beautiful service for Christmas. And then Sister Geraldine will be out here in the evening to have Christmas. She has a wonderful Christmas party on her Friday Night Live. Excuse me. Open Door Sunday Ministry. She always has a wonderful service. Lots of good food, lots of nice gifts for everyone, and I hope you'll come and join her for that. She's also going to be here tonight with her ministry, so if you need to have a nice hot dinner, come on down here and join her for this wonderful ministry. They have a service and songs and a speaker, and then food is served. So come on down and enjoy that tonight. I believe that's all of the announcements. Don't forget Monday night Bible study. He starts at, I forgot the time now. What time does Monday night Bible study start, James? Do you know? James, do you know what time the Monday night Bible study starts?
6 o'clock.
Starts at 6? Okay. So if you can't get to a daytime Bible study, but you still want your feeding of the Word, come in on Monday evening at 6 o'clock and join Brother Gary for that. I'd like to open our service with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, precious Lord God, we come before you this morning, Lord. Lord, we come before you humbly. We are grateful for another day, Lord. We are grateful, Lord, for all the blessings that you give to us. And we know, Lord, that we're still here because you have work yet for us to do. So, Father, we just pray and ask that you bless this day, bless each and every person who's in this building today, whether they be here now or they arrive a little later. And, Lord, we ask that you place a hedge of protection around this place today, placing your warrior angels at our doors, Father, to watch over us, to draw their swords and do battle with the enemy should he try to come in and disrupt our service. Father, we know where we are, and we know that there's the possibility of disruption on a daily basis. But Lord, we just pray that you protect us and give us your peace in here today, the peace that only you can provide, Father. Father, we ask that you bless this service from beginning to end. Bless our prayers. Bless our songs. Bless our praise team. Give them an extra measure today, an extra special anointing. Lord, bless our sound system. There's no problems with that. Bless our ushers, Father. They wear many hats and they work very hard. We thank you, Lord, for them very much. And Lord, bless our pastor as he's still convalescing. And bless Minister Eugene, who's going to come up here today and give the word. I'm sure he has a mighty message to deliver to us today, a powerful message. So Lord, just bless us coming in, bless us going out. Bless our offering today, Father. And Lord, just thank you for this wonderful sanctuary where we can come together and worship your holy name as a family. Lord, we thank you for all you do. And we ask all these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
All right. How many of you feel a breakthrough coming your way? Come on, I know everybody should know this song. It just simply said, I feel a breakthrough coming your way. It's a mighty move of God. It's going to change your day. Signs and wonders, miracles to perform. God's gonna bless you, but just holding on. I feel a breakthrough. I feel a breakthrough coming your way. It's a mighty move of God. It's gonna change your day. Signs and wonders, miracles to perform.
I believe that God is on the way. Thank you.
fest. Amen. That's right. Give the Lord a hand praise. God wants you to praise Him right now. Don't just praise Him waiting on your blessing to come. You got to bless your, you got to praise your way through the storm. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I'm going to see if we can do this other song, the first song.
We're going to see if we can do it now. We got volume.
Amen. It feels good to give God praise. There's something about praising God. Amen. Praise God.
I mean, you know it's more than that. You might as well put those hands together.
Back.
God has done, when you think about all that God is doing, and when you think about all that God is about to do,
it's more than all of that. Amen. It's God all by himself. Amen. So that's why we always like to worship God. Amen. The Bible says that God goes all over the earth looking for those that are not ashamed to worship. Amen. He sees those of us that are sitting here in his presence and still refuse to worship him. Amen. Amen. He know how to get us a place where we cry out. Oh, Lord.
Amen.
So this song is just a reminder that he's a holy God and we should worship him in holiness. Amen. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah, God. We worship you. We give you all the praise. Hallelujah. Hallowed be thy name. Praise his name.
Holy, holy. Lord, you're worthy. And I'm honored to sing your praise. King of glory, God Almighty, hallowed be your name.
All creation, every nation has its being by your word.
Thank you.
praise team is wonderful. And speaking of praise team, Brother Joe is here today. Come to visit us all the way from Ohio. Thank you for coming, and his lovely Harriet sit there next to him. So nice to see both of you. Yeah.
Happy to be here.
Yeah. You got to talk to Pastor Tony for a minute. Yeah, so, okay. He happened to call me, and I just ran out here with the phone.
Anyway,
I would like to welcome our world right now. And as you know, this world is in desperate need of prayer. The Lord's got his hand on everything. He knows what's happening. He knows what's happening, and he knows how to fix it. But he wants to hear from us. He wants to hear our prayers. Even though he already knows, he still wants to hear us pray, because it shows that we have faith in him. It shows that we believe in him. And we know that he is an all-powerful and almighty God. There's nothing he can't do. So I hope you'll join me in this prayer. Heavenly Father, precious Lord God, we come before you once again. Lord, we come before your throne of grace and mercy.
Yes, Lord.
We come before your throne of power and might. And we know, Lord, that the world leaders think they're running everything, but they're not. We know who sits on that throne. And we know that you put kings on their thrones, and when it's time, you take them off. When they're not doing the job right, you deal with it. And you know what's going on down here, Father. You know everything that's happening. And many times, Lord, I know you're not any happier about it than we are. But you have a plan. You have a plan. You're able to look down the corridors of time and decide when things are going to happen. And you make them happen. So, Father, we love you, we trust you, and we know that you're in charge. We put our faith in you. We put all our faith in you, Father. And Lord, there's so much violence in this world today, so much hatred. So much hatred from one person to another, from one country to another. Lord, we ask that you give us peace. We need peace on earth. Peace on earth. Goodwill toward men and women. I'm going to leave them out.
That's right.
Did a little rewrite on that one, Lord. I know that you regard every single person on this planet just the same. So, Father, we thank you for all you do. And, Lord, I ask for a special blessing today on the homeless people in our community. Father, they have special problems. They're out there in the night air, and it's cold out there. It's cold. Lord, I pray that you give them shelter. I pray that you give them warmth. I pray that you keep a roof over their heads and help them to find the shelter they need. Father, let them have clean water to drink and good food to eat, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Bless them. Bless them. And Lord, we thank you for all the gifts you provide here for us today. I'm hoping the groceries arrive during the service, and we do have goodies and coffee to serve. All because of you, Father. All because of you. Your provision has been phenomenal. Just phenomenal. Every single day. And Lord, we thank you for all you do. Father, grant us your peace. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Let the church say,
amen.
Means we agree with that prayer, right? Amen. It is offering time. I see one cheerful giver. It is time for us to bless God back. Amen. We find out that when we bless God, we're just blessing him back for what he's already done. But this is our time to bless God. Finances with your resources. Amen. And the Bible says we're supposed to give God the first of our fruit. Amen. If you wait until you pay all your bills and then you give unto God, do you know you're not? The devil gonna make sure you ain't got nothing left.
That's right.
So God was due him off. Put him on top and watch God put you on top. Amen. So as we worship, we're going to worship God with our tithes and our offering. And the praise team is going to simply make a declaration that we need the Lord. Amen.
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 We need you.
God. Amen. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. I'm going to just say a prayer over the offering. Dear Father God, we just come to your throne, God. Father, we just say thank you for all that you have done, for all that you're doing. Father, we thank you for the offering on today. We thank you for the givers that are in the house, God. We thank you, dear God, for those who are not ashamed to give, but that trust you with our finances to give, God. We know that some are giving out of their lack, God. But Father, you're a God that there's no lack in you. And when we trust you, God, with our finances, dear God, we already know that your word is true. And you declare that you would bless us, pressed down, shaking together, running. You said men will give into our bosom. Father, you said you will open up the windows of heaven and pour us out a blessing that we don't have room to receive. So Father, to all the givers in the house, bless each and every one. Bless those that not only gave, but Father, bless those that wanted to give and just didn't have it in their pocket. We know there's some giving that if they just had it, they would give too. So we pray that you bless them too, dear God. So they too can sow seed. So they too can reap the harvest, God, of being a giver. To all the laborers that are in the house. Father, this is a church that requires laborers. This house doesn't work by itself, God. Not only, Father God, to labor, but Father, we're holding up the pastor's vision for this community. That we labor together in love, God. We labor in unity, God. That there be no schism and no division, because we know that when we're walking in unity, that's when you bless the house, God. So I pray, God, that you bless this house. And bless all the laborers, dear God. Father, bless everyone that took time out of their day to be here this morning. They're giving the first fruit of their day, God. They're seeking ye first, God, the kingdom of heaven and his righteousness. And you said when we do it like that, you said all things will be added unto us. Bless each and every one. Bless our dear brother Joseph, that he's in the house, God. And Father God, we just, as much as we wanted to hear him, have him labor on today, we'd much rather just see that beautiful smile that's on his face. Amen. And just bless everyone. Bless all the ministers that are in the house. Bless everybody, dear God, in a special way. This is a time of giving. This is a season of giving. And some of us may not have to give, God. But Father, we just pray that you just bless each and every one in a special way. In Jesus' holy name I pray. Let us agree with that prayer. Say amen. Amen. Come on, let's give the Lord another hand and pray. Amen. It feels good to worship and give God some praise. Amen. But this is the season to be where we all celebrate. We're celebrating the birth of Christ. Amen. And this is a season of giving. Amen. So we're going to have on next Sunday, we're going to do all the Christmas song, amen. But this particular Sunday, we decided to just share one. So you guys can come back. Yeah, if you want to sing the Christmas songs, you got to come back next week, amen. But we're going to get it started just a little bit and share this song, amen. Amen. Come on, I know everybody.
I'm gonna go believe it together.
the Lord a hand prayer. I just want to make one announcement.
Hallelujah!
We will be having a Christmas program right here in the church. We've been having a Christmas program since the Open Door Ministry's been here. So if those of you don't have anything to do, it just so happens that next Christmas Eve is falling on next Sunday. So come to the Christmas service in the morning, and then if you want to be a part of a beautiful Christmas Eve service, we're going to be here that evening, starting at 7 p.m. Amen?
Good morning.
Good morning, church. How's everybody? Looking good. They call this Christmas season, the season for giving. That's what they say anyway. First thing I'm gonna do, like I do every time I get up here to bring the words, I'm gonna give all honor, all praise to the Father God. I just thank him. I thank him for allowing me to be able to come up here and to minister the word to you. I hope that we all receive something from God's word today. Now, the next thing I'm gonna do is something I do every time I preach. Take 1 minute of quiet time.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
1 minute of quiet time. I need an usher on each door. I don't want nobody coming in or going out. And I need 1 minute. I want everybody to take 1 minute of quiet time and talk to God. Invite him into your heart. Tell him you want to hear his word today. Amen?
Amen.
1 minute. Almighty Father, creator that brought life into existence, I come this day before your throne of grace and mercy. I ask that you forgive all of us of our unworthy acts and deeds. Forgive us for any sin that we have committed against you in mind, body, and soul. Father, on this day, let every word that flows from my mouth be in spirit and in truth. Let every word, Father God, be representing you. It is your will that I choose to fulfill. It is your way that I choose to follow. So, my God, let your light shine upon this house of worship this day. In the mighty name of thy Son, Jesus Christ, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, we pray. And all the saints who are in agreement with this prayer can say,
Amen.
I did want to introduce the minister of music, Brother Joseph Warren, back in the house. Everybody know the minister of music and his wife, Sister Harriet Warren, in the house today. You know, it's always a pleasure for me to see my brother, because I sung with that brother for a lot of years, man. A lot of years, you know. He have touched the heart of many of us in here, including all of you guys out there, because I know y'all know how it was when we had a full band up here singing it to the Lord. Yes. So anyway, the title of today's sermon is the gift that never stopped flowing. The gift that never stopped flowing. I think we know what that is. Before I even get into the message, I know you know what it is. Because see, they recognize this time as a season for giving. But see, God don't recognize a season. God recognizes every day. Every moment of the day, every second of the day, God recognized as a time for giving. The message is coming out of John 3:16-18, and I'm sure everyone in here know where that's at in your Bible if you care to open up. Can we all stand for the reading? Word of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And the word of God says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already.
That's right.
Because he had not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. Amen. You may sit down. I would like for you to remember three words from that scripture that we just read. The first word is gave. The second word is sent. And the third word is belief. Belief. These words represent the most significant action ever been performed. And it was and is impossible for any human being to perform. God had a plan in place for salvation to come after the fall of man. See, God knew you. God knew you already. In Jeremiah 1:5, it say this, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. And before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee and ordained thee a prophet unto the nation. See, God told Jeremiah that he knew him before he was in the womb. Before he was in the womb. He wasn't even formed yet. But I want you to look at yourself today and think about what God is saying. Because he's not just talking to Jeremiah. He's talking to you too.
That's right. Come on.
He's letting you know that before you was ever you in your mama's womb, he knew you.
Yes, sir.
Huh?
Yes, sir.
I just picked out a son and a mother.
Yes, sir.
Before any of us was in our mother's womb, God already knew us. There's nothing that God don't know about us. He knew and still know everything about every creation that he created. God know right now. Jesus coming into this world was not an accident or incident that just happened. spoken in the times of old. Jesus' coming was spoken in the times of old. In Isaiah 7:14, he said this, "Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel." Emmanuel, God is with us. A virgin. Think about it. Kent will conceive. A virgin. Never been touched by man. She's a virgin. Clean. God looked down upon her and saw righteousness in her. And this woman he used to bring the Lord Jesus Christ into existence. He said in Isaiah 9:6-7, he said this. He said, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders. And his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace."
Yes, sir.
"Of the increase of his government and peace there shall be no end.
Yeah.
Upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth, ever, forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform." A child is going to be born.
Yes, sir. Say that.
He's going to carry the world on his shoulders.
Yes.
Huh?
Thank you, Lord.
Carry you.
Yes.
Every day of your life, Jesus is carrying you up on his shoulders. Every day, he's carrying you. And he's waiting on you to make the choice. In Isaiah 59:20, it says this, "Messiah will come to Zion. He will bring redemption for all those who turn away from their sin." See, all through the Old Testament, it was focused on the Messiah. It was focused on the coming of Christ. It was focused on Jesus, our Christ. The ones that we know. All through the Old Testament, it was focused on him. So Jesus was known already. Jesus was known before the New Testament. See, the New Testament is about Christ. But the Old Testament, everybody was waiting on him. They knew about him, but they was waiting on him. The Hebrew word for Messiah means anointed one, chosen one. The Greek word for Messiah means anointed one. Chosen one.
Yes, sir.
The English word for Messiah means,
come on, brother,
Christos, known as the Christ.
Yes, sir.
Christos, known as the Christ. Christ, known as the anointed one, the chosen one, the redeemer, the deliverer, the Savior of the world.
Come on, brother.
Christ Jesus is the Savior of the world.
Yes,
he's the Messiah they was waiting on.
Yes, sir.
They was looking for him, but he came to you.
Yes.
They wanted to see him, but he came to you.
Thank you, Lord. Yes, sir. Thank you. Thank you.
God is good. I gave you three words to remember. Those three words was gay, set, and believe. And them three words breaks down everything that was spoken in the passages that we read. Gay represents something that you look for on Christmas, but you can find it every day. Because through God, Jesus was a free gift.
Yes, he was.
That's right.
Come on, brother. Yes, he was.
It ain't about this season.
No.
This season was created by man to try to represent the birth of Christ. But what's so funny about that? They don't even know his birth. No one knows his birth. They just figured he was born around the season. So they took this season to represent him as one who gives, gave, represent a free gift that was given to you. But guess what? That gift opened the door to you every day. Not only he don't open it, it never closes. It never closes. That door is open to you day after day, moment after moment, minute after minute, year after year. That door never closes to you. The only time that door closes is when sinners trying to walk through. See, why? Because to go through that door, you got to repent.
Yes, sir.
Huh? Say what?
Come on.
You got to repent.
That's right.
The second word says sent. I told you to remember that. Represent a command that was given by God to Christ. He sent him in the world not to condemn you, that he may give you life and life abundantly. He sent him to save you. That word sent, Christ was sent to you. He was given to you as a free gift, and he was sent to you because you needed him. Because we needed a savior. Because we was dead in sin.
Yes,
and he died to save you.
Yes, he did. Thank you, Lord.
Yep.
Thank you, Lord.
Yep.
Yes, sir.
That word belief. That word belief means trusting in him without doubt.
Yes.
Trusting in him without doubt. See, if you got any doubt, you don't truly believe.
That's right. Come on, brother. That's right.
If you got any doubt in you about him, you do not truly believe. The word gave is God's trademark. Our God is a God in the giving business. It is not a seasonal operation for the Father. It is his business day after day after day. God is a giver.
Yes, he is.
God don't need nothing from you.
Nothing.
There's nothing you have that he needs. Why would he need your money? He own all the gold in the world.
That's right. Come on, brother.
Huh? Why would he need your house? He got a kingdom. God don't need nothing for us but one thing: for us to repent. Repent. Jesus came into this world to give life and life abundantly. The plan of God was already in place when He gave you free will. He knew he gave you authority over your life choices. See, God gave you free will from creation. And from creation, he gave you the authority to make a decision for your own life. He knew that something we would make bad decisions sometimes, that we would disrupt our lifestyle that he created. See, when God created Adam, he created a perfect man. He created a man without sin in him. God used to walk in the garden and talk with Adam. A righteous God don't walk with sin. The Bible teaches you that. It teaches you that God looked upon sin and what happened? He got to judge it. He has to judge it. For God had already accounted for our mistakes before creation. If he knew you before creation, that means he already knew that you were going to make a mistake. He already knew. See? And he had things right in place. In John 10:10, Jesus said this. He said, "The thief come out not but for to steal, to kill, and destroy." He said, "I am come." Did you notice what that said? I am. Who's I am? I am come that they might have life and they might have it more abundantly.
That's right. Yes.
I am. God came, as Gary said earlier, into this world. He jumped in a body. God got into a body just to save you.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Just to save you. That word abundance means so much. It means unmeasurable love, unmeasurable life, unmeasurable peace, unmeasurable joy, unmeasurable understanding, unmeasurable knowledge, unmeasurable wisdom, eternal life. That word, abundance, means so much, but it is all good. It is all good. It is all from the fruit of the Spirit. It's all from God. Very gift that God gives is a gift of life, prosperity, and of love. His gift and love is not just a season, but it's seasonal, meaning every day of your life, every day of our life. God is right beside you no matter where you at. I don't care if you're homeless on the street, or if you're inside the church. I don't care if you're laying out drunk or on drugs. God is standing right there. Waiting on you. All you got to do is call on him. All you got to do is submit to him. All you have to do, turn your life around. Repent. That's why in times of heartache and pain, God said, come as you are. When you're hungry, God said, come as you are. When you're broke and ain't got no money in your pocket, God say, come as you are. When you're homeless and have nowhere to lay your head, God say, come as you are. When you're blind, when you're crippled, when you're lame, when you have mental problems, when you can't talk, you have a speech impediment, God say, come as you are. There's no healer like our God. We got many people that proclaim to be this, to be that. But there's only one healer.
Amen. That's God.
That's our Father. See, we need to seek God for who he is. He's love all by himself. He watches over us day and night, in good times and bad times. All God wants from us is to be in the mind of the prodigal son and know the door's open.
Yeah.
We know about the prodigal son. I preached on him the last time I was up here. How he did all he did and squandered all of his belongings. And he thought in his head that the servant in his father's house eat better than him. Everybody in his father's house eat better than him. And he went home. And just like God, the father opened his arms and welcomed his son in. Showing from way off to this is my son. What did he say about it? He said, my son was lost, but now he's found. And then what he said, God is trying to tell you the same thing day in and day out. God is telling you, even in your time where you are lost, even in your time where you don't understand what's going on in your life, I'm right here. I'm right here. All you got to do is turn to me. All you got to do is call on me. All you got to do is repent of your old ways. And let's begin this ship floating in new. You see, you don't need to close on your back when you go in a coffin. Huh? Yeah. You don't need that big house on the hill when you get in that coffin. You don't need all that money you just won from the lottery when you go in that coffin. Huh? You don't need nothing of this world when you go in that coffin. Because the coffin is calling for death, but God is calling for life.
That's right. Yes.
As Job said, he said, naked I came into this world, and naked I shall live. That's what Job said. So when you get in that coffin, you ain't in no position to spend a dime on all that money you got in the bank. Because your kids going to be back there talking about, hey, she gone, that's mine now. Yeah, woo, I'm going to drive this Mercedes now. She wouldn't let me drive it when I was here, but woo, I got it now, let's ride. Just think about it. Just think about it. I know that. For a fact, a true fact. See, what you need is one called Emmanuel.
That's right. Yeah.
And they call him by so many different names. You need to know those names because they're important to you. They call him Jehovah. Yeah. Who is Jehovah? God of creation. Jehovah. They call him Jehovah Rohi, the Lord, my shepherd.
That's right. Come on, brother.
They call him Jehovah Jireh, the Lord, my provider.
Yes.
They call him Jehovah Rapha, the Lord,
my healer.
My healer. They call him Jehovah Nisi, the Lord, my banner or my strength. They call him Jehovah Kadosh, the Lord who sanctified me. That name, Jehovah, means so much. That's God's name. And God is the one that can reach down and touch you anytime, he wants, anywhere you are at. He can reach down and touch you. See, he's the one that can take your life and turn it around in an instant. See, man can take your life and turn it around in an instant. See, man ain't gonna do nothing to lead you down a road of destruction. But Jesus Christ said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And there's no way to the Father but through me. Jesus said, pick up your cross and follow me. He didn't say carry his cross. He said, pick up yours. He said, you can't carry my cross. Because my cross carried the whole world on it. That's too heavy for you. You take that pound, I take these 10,000 pounds. See? But follow me. Walk in these footsteps that I'm going to lay out for you. Let me show you the way. People of God, we must understand that life and death is all a part of this journey in this world.
That's right.
This journey is an opportunity that God gave us to use to decide your own destiny. When you see babies that are stillborn, God knows them and have a place with them already. When you see the young children get killed at a young age, God knows them. And God has a place for them already. See? These things, but people who are allowed to exist and live life, you have a choice to make.
That's right.
Me and you, or me and y'all, we have a choice.
That's right.
See, babies are still born, they don't have a choice. They couldn't make the choice. God already got them in his arms.
That's right.
Little kids that wasn't able to make decisions, you don't have to worry about them. God got them in his arms. But you and me, that God has gave a life to live, in this world, we got a choice to make.
Come on, brother.
And that choice is completely up to you. See, God do not take choices from you because that's your free will. He implemented free will to be for your decision at creation. Day you die. In Deuteronomy 30:19, the word of God said this: this day I call heaven and earth as a witness. Now listen at that. He said, this day I call who? Heaven and earth. Does heaven and earth have life in it? Evidently it does, right? Because witnesses have life.
That's right.
Heaven and earth have life. As a witness against you that I have set before you, life and death, blessings and curses, now choose life so you and your children, check it out. He didn't say choose life just for yourself, did he? He said, choose life for you and your children, that you may live. Living is not on this earth.
That's right.
See, let's not get it twisted when he says so that you can live. Living is not on this earth.
That's right.
Living is being with God.
That's right. That's right. Hallelujah.
In Mark 10:17, King James Version said this, and when he gave, and when he was gone forth into the way, there came one running and kneeled to him and asked him, God, good master, what shall I do that I may inherit eternal life? So now we're talking about the rich man. The Hebrew. The Jew. One that was considered righteous. And he ran up to Jesus and said, good master, what shall I do that I may have? Jesus looked at him and said, well, keep all the commandments. And then he began to name off, thou shalt not have no other God, thou shalt not bear false witness, thou shalt not. Jesus began to name them off. And he said, well, I did that all my life. Jesus looked at him and said, well, if you want to be perfect, he said, sell everything that you have and give to the poor and follow me.
Right.
Now, that was a rich man. How do you think the rich man acted? Huh? You mean everything my father built up for me and gave me and left me? You mean all this wealth that I have, I'm just supposed to give it away? They don't put wealth in the coffin.
That's right.
Wealth don't go in the coffin. See? Because when you're walking with Christ, you don't even go in the coffin. The body go in the coffin. Acting from the body is what?
Present with the Lord.
The spirit goes to God. But the body goes in the coffin. See, this is America. And America is financially a rich country. Very rich. You think we have to have homeless people out here on the street? No. America, some of the people that's just out there making millions got enough money to take the homeless off the street. So why can't America do it? Why don't America take the homeless off the street? America don't know what love is because they don't know God. It say God bless America, but God don't bless sin. God don't bless sin. Therefore, America, when you talk about end time America, you can't be blessed by God unless you repent and give yourself to God. God wants America to repent. You got to know God. You got to have a relationship with God. You got to understand who God is. You got to understand why God choose a certain way. See? Because in God's way, there's something that you understand that America can't teach you. In God's way, there's something that every man that go to God understand that America can't teach you. And what is that?
Love.
Love. America don't teach love. America teach financial growth, prosperity in the worst way. Now don't get me wrong, Nothing wrong with having money. Nothing wrong with being rich financially. See, nothing wrong with having a nice house and a nice car. Ain't nothing wrong with having nice things. But the first commandment says this, thou shalt have no other God before me. Can you have all these things and still put God first? Can you have them and put God first? You have to put God first in order to be part of God's kingdom. You have to put him first. That was the very first commandment of the 10th commandment that he gave to Moses. Thou shalt have no other God before me. And when Jesus was leaving, he gave another commandment. He said that you should love your neighbors as yourself. Do we know about that? We got a lot of selfish people in this world. But that's this world. Because Jesus said, I'm not a part of this world. He said, I'm in this world, but I'm not a part of this world. But I came to give you life and life abundantly. Jesus wants you to realize your destiny. Jesus wants you to realize that this journey in this world is a short journey. That you are going to live, but you're also going to die. And if you paid attention to anyone that died and left this world, you don't know where their spirit is at, but you do know they died. They died. The thing is, are you going to know where your spirit is going? Yes, amen. See, every man's salvation is about him and his relationship to God. You cannot save your mother. You cannot save your father, your son, your daughter, your sister, your brother. You cannot save them. Salvation is an individual choice by the person that wants salvation. So you see, God sent you a gift that are constantly flowing every day. And it's up to you to choose that gift. Ladies and gentlemen, the title of the message today, it's the gift that never stopped blowing.
That's right.
The Christmas story. It's all through the Bible too, because my brother just he went on into the Old Testament. Long before. You know, but I want just 2 points that I'm gonna, that's so crucial that my brother shared.
Right.
About to close the door. As long as you're living, I want you to hear me, as long as you're living, the door's open.
Right.
And there's only 2 ways the door will close. You die with rejecting Christ in your sins, the door is closed.
Yeah.
Or Christ, the Lord Jesus comes back.
Glory.
And you have not received him. The door is closed.
That's right.
But today the door is open.
That's right. Come on.
Because God says it in his word. Today is the day of salvation.
That's right, come on, baby.
Now is the acceptable time. Today. So it has in your heart and your mind that you got time. You better make sure.
You don't got time.
Because you don't know.
That's right.
If you're going to walk out this door.
That's right.
And drop dead that God called you to account. So I'm going to turn it over to my sister Geraldine.
All right.
And the next point that my brother is imperative, there's two conditions God called man to. Repentance and faith.
Right.
Repentance and faith.
Praise the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. This is the part of the service where we want to give you an opportunity to respond. Wasn't that a beautiful message on today? Amen. We thank God not only for the message, we thank God for the messenger. Can we show Minister Eugene some love? It was a beautiful message. Amen. Amen. But this is your part now. This is the part where you get to respond. And he gave us the word of the Lord. Amen. He not only gave us the word of the Lord, but he let us know that this, don't get comfortable here. Your job here is to make preparation for where you're going to go when you leave here. God made it possible for us all to say yes to Christ. Amen. So this is the altar call. This is the part where you get an opportunity to say yes to Jesus for yourself. Amen. The day is going to come when we're all going to go before God. And the Bible said there's nobody that's going to come that's going to be able to say, I didn't know. You heard it today. You heard it today. God is holding you accountable today. Why wait? You're here now. Why wait? You might as well. Isn't this a beautiful time to say yes to Christ? So if you would like to say yes to the Lord on today, amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a hand praise. Amen. It's so beautiful. Amen. Amen. If you're not too ashamed to come forward, can you come forward if you would like to say yes to the Lord on today? This is the altar call, and I believe there's more than one. Amen. If you feel God tugging at your heart, you're the one. Hallelujah, Lord Jesus. Praise your holy name. Hallelujah. If you're too shy to come forward, if you just want to stand, you can stand at your seat. Hallelujah, Lord Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Amen. Come on, come on. You know he's tugging at your heart. Hallelujah, Lord Jesus. The other call is this. If there's someone under the sound of my voice, someone has stood up. Let's give the Lord a hand praise. God bless you. I know it takes courage. Amen. Come on, they're standing up, y'all. Let's give the Lord another hand praise. Amen. That's the Holy Spirit moving through the room right now. Amen. Touching the heart. The other call is this. If there's someone under the sound of my voice, you may have already said yes to Christ, but you may have walked away from God, the prodigal son. Amen. Amen. But you know when he came back to open arms. Amen. He didn't come back to judgment. He came back to forgiveness. So if you want to come back to God on today, I think I'm here tonight. Go on and stand if you want to come back to God. This call is for the one that want to come back. Is there one? Amen. We're going to say a prayer. We call it the sinner's prayer. This is the prayer that if you say it with a sincere heart, according to Romans 10:9, you shall be saved. So even if you're still in your seat, you can still get in on it. All you have to do is confess with your mouth, be sincere with your heart, and this prayer will be unto you too. Let's pray. Dear God, forgive me of all my sins. I repent from all of my sins. Lead me, guide me, order my steps. I believe Jesus died for my sins. I want him to be my Lord and my Savior. Holy Spirit, fill me with your power. Lead me, guide me. Satan, I rebuke you. From this day forward, I serve you no more. I put you under my feet in Jesus' name. Dear God, deliver me, heal me, set me free. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. Come on, put those hands together. Somebody got to shout. Shout hallelujah.